We go to the phones. Republican strategist Matt Mikowiak. Matt, good morning. How are you?
Good morning, Chad. I'm doing great. How you doing?
I'm doing great. Appreciate you joining us today. A lot going on in the news. A lot happening. I want to start with this past Friday in a debate that surely tens of people watched between Lupe Valdez and Andrew White. Afterwards, the Houston Chronicle came out and endorsed Andrew White in that race? I mean, Lupe Valdez, she's supposed to be the so-called front runner, but it just doesn't seem like she really is.
Yeah, you know, I saw Lupe Valdez said, well, she doesn't talk newspaper talk, she talks people talk, which is, I don't know who thought of that line, but that person needs to be fired immediately. You know, that debate, as you said, I mean, it was only available on television in Austin and San Antonio, nowhere else around the state. It was being held 3 days before early voting. You know, this Democratic gubernatorial, you know, primary runoff has really gotten almost no attention. You have really, I think, two pretty lackluster candidates. Valdez does have the sort of machinery of the Democratic Party behind her. She was actively recruited by the party. You know, pretty much anyone who's associated with the Democratic Party in Texas is supporting her. There are a couple exceptions here and there, a couple groups here and there, some people in Houston that Andrew White, you know, knows personally, they're supporting him. What's interesting about the race is, in some ways, it's going to show, you know, whether sort of the party organization or money matters more on the Democratic side, because White has significantly, you know, more money, but mostly because he's invested his own money in his race. But he is, I guess, technically a more moderate candidate than Valdez is, particularly on the issue of abortion, where I guess he has sort of the Joe Biden, Tim Kaine view that he is personally opposed to abortion, but won't be opposed to it in office.
Yeah.
And so, you know, abortion and electability, I think, were two of the big issues in the debate. I'm not sure the debate mattered enough that it was going to change sort of the dynamic of the race. I think Valdez is still likely to be the nominee. But if it's low turnout across the state, if White is better known than Valdez, which is a big if, but it's possible given his financial advantage, there could be a surprise.
Very interesting. We'll watch and see as that happens. Are there any races on the Republican side in Texas that you're paying attention to, or are all things kind of quiet?
Well, there's several congressional races really on both sides of the aisle that have runoffs. You know, there's a Republican and a Democratic runoff in 21. This is the Lamar Smith seat that goes from Austin down to San Antonio in the Hill Country. You know, there's a couple runoffs up in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. The Joe Barton seat has a runoff on the Republican side. The Jeb Hensarling seat has a runoff in outside of Dallas on the Republican side. There's a really hotly contested Democratic congressional runoff in Houston in the Culberson seat, one that Democrats are trying to make competitive, where you have sort of a Bernie Sanders progressive versus a more of a mainstream Democrat running. So, you know, Blake Farenthold's seat is up for a runoff as well. You know, I think these aren't races that have sort of statewide significance. I don't really think any of them are really going to affect who controls the House, because fundamentally I don't believe really any of the seats that Republicans hold in Texas are likely to become Democratic. But we'll see. It depends on how big the wave is this year. It looked pretty big 3 months ago. It looks smaller now, the Democratic wave, than it did 3 months ago. So we're obviously still 5 months out, and we have to see kind of what the political environment looks like.
Yeah, you just hit on something I was going to ask you next, which is the blue drip that we're now seeing as Trump's numbers are going up. You don't hear this blue wave talk anymore. Democrats have kind of tamped that down a little bit. It's obviously this is good news for Republicans. What can they do to capitalize on it and really get Republican voters out to the polls in the midterms?
Yeah, look, Trump's had a good few weeks, and you know, he deserves credit for that. Whether it's bringing those hostages home, continuing to develop you know, positive signs with North Korea, pulling out of the Iran deal, moving the embassy in Israel to Jerusalem, which was unveiled this morning. You know, he's delivering on promises he made as a candidate, and I guess that's perceived as radical these days in politics, because most candidates say they're going to do things and then they don't do them once they get elected. Trump's really, really, really stuck with everything he said he'd do, and you know, for his base and for people that agree with him, certainly he has put some wins up on the board. So number one, what I would say is, you know, to the extent that Trump can continue to see his numbers improve, I think that's really important to the party in the midterms. If this election is about Trump, I think that's what Democrats want. That's not necessarily what Republicans want. They want, you know, each race to be an individual race between the candidates, the dynamics, you know, who the incumbent is, sort of local issues. The Democrats are trying to nationalize all these races because Trump was pretty weak politically. He was in the mid-30s, high 30s most of last year, and even early this year. He appears to now be in the low 40s, perhaps moving to the mid-40s. And I think that's an important difference. You know, even the right track, wrong track numbers look pretty strong. And, of course, the economy keeps getting stronger. So, number one, obviously, I think to the extent that Trump can improve his numbers, that's significant. I think the bigger question is, what are Republicans going to try to do the rest of this year? Obviously, the outlook for legislative accomplishments this year is pretty bleak, just realistically speaking. But that doesn't mean that they can't advance issues, highlight contrasts. Looks like they do have a chance maybe to do something on prison reform, which is an important issue that has a bipartisan coalition. The Texas Public Policy Foundation in Austin has been a real leader on that. So, look, they're going to, you know, the House is going to work on, I think, trying to claw back some spending. I think the Senate is unlikely to do anything. The Senate's going to spend a lot of time confirming judges, which is really important. They confirmed 5 or 6 just in the last couple weeks. But, you know, I think there is going to be a spending fight in September because the spending bill expires. And so and Trump has said he's not going to sign another bad bill. And so it's going to be interesting to see if either side blinks or if they're able to punt that past the midterm election. But, yeah, look, the environment is improving for Republicans. We're still 5 months out. There's a lot that can happen.
Yeah, you wrote a piece last week for the Washington Examiner about the maximum pressure technique that the president has pushed on North Korea and that applying towards Iran now. Do you think that we're going to see sort of the same roadmap? And can we assume that maybe this will play out the same way, that the Iranians will eventually come to the table? And will the Europeans decide that, okay, this is the right technique to go down?
Yeah, that was my weekly column in the Washington Times on Thursday. I did make the case that basically the initial success the Trump administration is having with North Korea does provide a roadmap for Iran. Obviously, you didn't have the same circumstance. Countries are different. There are regional differences, religious differences. You have different allies in each region that have different relationships with America and with the countries you know that you're talking about. But what's clear is that in North Korea, you know, Trump was seen as more credible in terms of how tough he was being with them. And the maximum pressure campaign that the Trump administration has put on North Korea for 15 or 16 months, consistently, relentlessly, you know, joint military exercises, putting the two most sweeping sanctions packages ever passed in the United Nations, persuading China to further isolate North Korea, all those things put North Korea in a position where they had to change their approach. Now, we'll have to see what happens with the deal. I mean, it's going to have to be a very good deal. Trump continues to say he will not, you know, sign a bad deal, a deal similar to the Iran deal. The question now is, as we move towards that June 12th summit in North Korea, is now that he's pulled out of the Iran deal, can they put a maximum pressure campaign on in Iran? And I think that is a question. Right now, you have our European allies that, I guess, want to stay in the deal with Iran. Well, one of the things Trump said when he announced he was pulling out is anyone that does business with Iran could be sanctioned by the United States. I mean, that would mean France, it would mean England, it would mean Germany. That would be a significant step. So for now, I think the U.S. is going to put sanctions on. They're going to see how the European allies respond. But if they want to take what worked in North Korea and apply it, perhaps in a tailored way to Iran, seems to me they have a roadmap that worked in one part of the world. They might as well try it with Iran, because it's clear the Iran deal was not working. Yeah. I think, you know, the argument that it was working is being made by partisans that have, you know, their own careers invested in that argument. The Iran deal was really a significant failure, and I think more and more people are starting to see that.
Matt Mikowiak, Republican strategist. Tell folks where they can sign up for your email and then also what your latest podcast is on.
Yeah, we do a morning email for the state of Texas called Must Read Texas. 3,000 Texans receive it every day. We take all the news from around the state, put it into one email, send it to you in the morning every weekday. You can sign up for a free one-week trial at mustreadtexas.com. The podcast is called Mac on Politics. It's with the Washington Times. Most recent episode is with Matthew Continetti, the editor-in-chief of the Washington Free Beacon, and we talked exclusively about the Iran deal. You'll learn quite a bit from that conversation. You can find it in the iTunes Store, on Google Play, on Stitcher, and at MacOnPoliticsPodcast.com.
Awesome. Matt, as always, have a great week. We'll visit with you next week.
Thanks, Chad. Take care.
Have a good one. That's Matt Mikowiak.